فؤادك الأيام فتى.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. Brothers and sisters, couple of days ago, nearly a week now, every one of us either saw or read or came across what took place in Paris. So inshallah ta'ala, my aim and objective today inshallah ta'ala is to talk about that matter that took place. What does the Sharia believe regarding it? So inshallah ta'ala, the way I hope to talk about it is just from one particular point. There are many angles that the matter can be spoken about, but I don't want to speak about it from any other angle except this particular one, which is the issue of contract and covenant. First of all, what we need to know, brothers and sisters, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as Muslims, He ordered us to fulfill the promises, the covenants, the oaths, the words that we give, that we stick to our words and that we don't break it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, وَأَوْفُوا بِالْعَهْدِ إِنَّ الْعَهْدَ كَانَ مَسْؤُولًا. Fulfill your promises, fulfill the oaths that you make. For verily, you are responsible for the promises that you make. So Allah explicitly orders us to fulfill our promises, and that we're responsible. إِنَّ الْعَهْدَ كَانَ مَسْؤُولًا. It's a responsibility, the day of judgment, which we're going to be questioned for. Allah praised His slaves, the mu'mineen, the true believers. Allah praised them. Praise them for what? For fulfilling the promises that they make. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, الَّذِينَ يُوفُونَ بِعَهْدِ اللَّهِ وَلَا يَنْقُذُونَ الْمِيثَاقِ. Allah said about the believers, they are those who fulfill the promises that they make, and they don't break their oaths. They don't break it. So that characteristics of fulfilling the promises that you make, sticking to what you've, the word that you've given, is alama min alamat al-iman. It's a sign from the signs of iman. And the opposite is the hypocrites. And the people who claim iman, who claim Islam, are the ones who, when they make promises, they don't stick to their promises. Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim, both of them narrated in their authentic book on the authority of Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma, that the Prophet said, أَرْبَعٌ مَنْ كُنَّ فِيهِ كَانَ مُنَافِقًا خَالِصًا. Anyone who has these four present in him, verily, he is a pure munafiq. And from those four things was, إِذَا وَعَدَ أَخْلَفْ. If he makes a promise, he breaks it. If he makes a promise, breaks it. He breaks that promise, or she breaks that promise. Brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us in the Quran that if the disbeliever asks us for shelter, and he asks us, the disbeliever, he asks from us that we give him a covenant, shelter, help, aid. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, He said that وَإِنْ أَحَدٌ مِّنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ اسْتَجَارَكَ. If one of the disbelievers, they come into your shelter, Allah says, فَأَجِرْهُ, give him shelter. حَتَّى يَسْمَعَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ, until he hears the words of Allah. ثُمَّ أَبْلِغْهُ مَأْمَنَهُ, and make him reach a safe place. ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّهُمْ قَوْمٌ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. And the reason is because they are a people who don't know. So Allah tells us in that verse that if they come, that we need to give it to them, the shelter that they request for. One person is enough to give a covenant and a contract, and every other Muslim has to adhere and to submit to that covenant that was given by that one particular person. And that is based on the hadith of Ummu Hani radiyallahu ta'ala anha. Ummu Hani, she said, ذهبت إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عام الفتح. She said, when the conquest, the year of the conquest of Mecca, she said, I went to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and so she said, I found him having a bath, and his daughter Fatima تستره, she was covering her father. She said, فسلمت عليه, I greeted him, and then he said, من هذه, who is this person? And then she said, فقلت أنا أمي هاني بنت أبي طالب. I am أمي هاني, the daughter of Abi Talib. The Prophet said to her, مرحبا بأمي هاني, welcome أمي هاني. When the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he finished his bath, and he prayed eight units of prayer. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he looked at Ummi Hani and she said to him, Ya Rasulullah, Ali ibn Abi Talib, he claims that he's going to kill a person. I have given them a shelter. I have given them a covenant. I have given them an oath. I've given my word to this person. And Ali ibn Abi Talib wants to come and kill that person. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he looked at Ummi Hani and he said to her, قَدْ أَجَرْنَا مَنْ أَجَرْتِ يَا أُمِّ هَانِي. We have given them safety, the person you've given safety to. قَدْ أَجَرْنَا مَنْ أَجَرْتِ يَا أُمِّ هَانِي. Ummi Hani, we are given safety to the person you've given safety to. So based on that hadith, what it shows us is one person is able to give shelter. And one person can bring the disbeliever into the Muslim land and no one is allowed to touch that person. Nu'aym ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, inshallah, now what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you guys examples of how the Messenger stuck to the words and the promises that he gave. And how he never broke a promise that he made, alayhi salatu wasalam. And that he didn't deceive. Nu'aym ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam said, alayhi salatu wasalam, and he said this statement of his, alayhi salatu wasalam, when two messengers came from a man by the name of Musaylamah al-Kadhab. Musaylamah was a man who claimed that he was a prophet. And so he sent two messengers to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. When the two messengers came to the Prophet said to the two of the messengers, both of the messengers, he said to them, what do you both believe about Musaylamah? And they said to the Prophet, innahu Rasulullah, Musaylamah is a messenger from Allah. The messenger then said to both of them, لو أن الرسول لو أن الرسل لا تقتل قتلتكما لو لولا أن الرسل لا تقتل قتلتكما. If the messengers were not those who were killed, meaning messengers weren't killed, if that policy, that universal principle or that universal law was not in place, that messengers were not killed, I would have killed you both. But because universally no one killed, and messengers are those who are not killed, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I won't kill you both. Meaning we don't deceive. Messengers, their job, a messenger is not killed. It's a universally agreed upon. What does that show you? Our Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam wasn't the one who made this covenant. And he was not the one who made this promise. But ma'a thalika, even then, he said, I won't kill you both. Imam Ahmad and Abi Dawood narrated this. Also, the great noble companion Abi Rafi' radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, قَدْ أَرْسَلَتْنِي قُرَيْشٌ. Quraysh sent me to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, I was sent to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I was sent to him. And when I was sent to him, I came, and when I saw the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَوَقَعَ فِي قَلْبِي شَيْءٍ. Something fell into my heart towards the Prophet. Meaning I started to love him. I wanted to remain with him. And I wanted to become one of his disciples, his companions. Then I told the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that I want to remain with you. And I don't want to go back. And I want to believe in you. The Messenger said to him, alayhi salatu wa sallam, إِنِّي لَا أُخِيسُ بِالْعَهْدِ وَلَا أَحْبُسُ الْبُرَدْ وَلَكِنْ ارْجِعْ إِلَى قَوْمِكَ فَإِنْ كَانَ فِي نَفْسِكَ الَّذِي فِيهَا فَإِنْ كَانَ فِي نَفْسِكَ الَّذِي فِيهَا الْآنُ فَرْجِعْ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, I don't break promises. And I don't imprison messengers. I don't imprison them. وَلَكِنْ but, go back to your people. If you go back to your people, and whatever you're feeling now still remains in your heart, it still remains in your heart, then with your own choice, come back to me. But the Messenger didn't accept him to do it now. Why? Because what they're going to say is that Muhammad, he broke the universal law that messengers are not imprisoned. He broke that promise and that he imprisoned the messenger. So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him that I don't break promises and I don't imprison the messengers that are sent, the delegations that are sent, I don't imprison them. This is a hadith narrated by Abi Dawood and Ahmed. Hudhayfah ibn al-Yaman radiallahu ta'ala anhumah, he said, ما منعني أن أشهد بدرا. Nothing stopped me from participating in the battle of Badr. Nothing stopped me. I mean, I could have participated in the battle of Badr, but the only thing that prevented me from participating in the battle of Badr and my father as well is that kuffar of Quraysh, the disbelievers, the people of Mecca, they found out that Hudhayfa and his father were both wanting to leave Mecca and that they both wanted to go to Medina. When they found out, they came to them both and said to them, إِنَّكُمْ تُرِيدُونَ مُحَمَّدًا. You both want Muhammad, huh? You both want Muhammad. And then they said, مَا نُرِيدُ. We don't want Muhammad. مَا نُرِيدُ إِلَّا الْمَدِينَ. The only place we want to go to is Medina. فَأَخَذُوا مِنَّا عَهْدَ اللَّهِ وَمِيثَاقَهُ. And they took a covenant, an oath, of the oath of Allah, وَمِيثَاقَهُ لَنَنْصَرِفَنَّ إِلَى الْمَدِينَ. That we're going to go to Medina, and that we're not going to be with Muhammad, and that we're not going to participate in the battle of Badr with him. They took that oath with us, and they gave it to them. وَلَا نُقَاتِلْ مَعَهُ. فَأَتَيْنَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. We came to the messenger, and we informed him. فَأَخْبَرْنَاهُ الْخَبَرْ. We informed him of what Quraysh did with us, that they took a covenant with us. The messenger, when he was told, he said, إِنْ صَرِفَا. Both of you go, leave us. نُفِيءَ لَهُمْ بِأَهْدِهِمْ وَنَسْتَعِينُ اللَّهَ عَلَيْهِمْ. We will fulfill their promise for them, and we will ask Allah, help from Allah unto them. Meaning, we will ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to support us in fighting towards them. But you too, go back, fulfill your promises that you made. And so what does that show us, brothers and sisters? That a Muslim sticks to the covenant and the promises that he makes. And now, we find that what took place in France, those people, they entered the country, a visa was given to them, and they came in and they deceived the people of the land by causing bloodshed within the land, in which they were given a covenant, a man's safety, a contract. Now the question that arises is, مَا يَنْعَقِدُ بِهِ الْأَمَانِ. What is that which a safety can be referred to? What's the dhabit for it? When can we say this is aman? When can it be? The ulama, they mentioned that the aman. So when can a person say, I have a contract with these people, or I have a covenant with them? When? The scholars, they say that the aman, the covenant, or a misaq, or a ahd, all of that, the scholars, they say the asal for it is what? أنه على التوسعة وليس على التضييق. And that it can be based upon مجرد الظن والإذن. What does that mean? It's mere assumption and speculation. Mere assumption and speculation. And I will explain that more. And permission. Permission is a contract. Also, mere assumption and speculation. And it's a matter which is أنه على التوسعة وليس على التضييق. And that means that this issue is very loose, and it's not what the matters that Sharia tightens. And I'll explain what that means. Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, As-Sa'id ibn Mansur, narrated in his Sunan, that Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, Wallahi law anna ahadakum ashara bi usbu'ihi ila samaa ila mushrikin. Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, anybody who points his finger to the sky and then to a mushrik. So he points his finger to the sky, and then he points it towards the mushrik. فَقَتَلَهُ. And then he kills the mushrik. فَنَزَلَ بِأَمَانِهِ. And the disbeliever thinks that you've given him safety. Because when you pointed your finger up the sky, and then you pointed towards him, the disbeliever thought you were trying to say that I have given you safety. But you weren't trying to say that. He thinks you said that. Huh? فَقَتَلَهُ. And you kill him. Umar radiallahu anhu said, لَقَتَلْتُهُ بِهِ. I will kill you for it. I will kill you for it. So all you've done is you pointed your finger at the sky, and you pointed at him, and the disbeliever thought you was giving him safety, so he came into the land, and then you killed him. Umar radiallahu anhu said, anyone who does that, فَقَتَلْتُهُ, I will. Umar radiallahu anhu, he's here, لَقَتَلْتُهُ, it doesn't mean I will kill him, but I will severely deal with him, he means. I will severely deal with him. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, rahimahullah, as is written in the book Al-Insaf and Al-Furu', and also Muwaffaquddin ibn Qudama, he mentions in his Kitab al-Mughni that Imam Ahmad is going to give us a dhabit, very powerful. Imam Ahmad said, إِذَا أُشِيرَ إِلَيْهِ إِذَا أُشِيرَ إِلَيْهِ أَيِّ الْكَافِرِ if it's pointed towards the kafir, بِشَيْءٍ أَيْ مَاتَى. Somebody points something towards the kafir. بِشَيْءٍ غَيْرَ الْأَمَانِ. But it really isn't safety. You said something, you indicated something, you pointed at something. It came across to him that you're giving him safety. غَيْرَ الْأَمَانِ. But it wasn't. You were rather saying to him, I will kill you. But he thought to himself that you were saying to him, I'll look after you. فَظَنَّهُ أَمَانًا. And the disbeliever thought you were giving him safety. فَهُ أَمَانٌ. It's a safety. You can't kill him. وَكُلُّ شَيْءٍ يَرَى الْعِلْجُ أَنَّهُ أَمَانٌ فَهُ أَمَانٌ. And anything that the disbeliever sees it to be safe, sees it to be a contract, it's a contract. The matter is based on what he thinks, not what you meant. This is important. The issue is not what you meant, it is what he understood it. وَكُلُّ شَيْءٍ يَرَى الْعِلْجُ. The ilj is the kafir. Everything that the kafir sees, أَنَّهُ أَمَانٌ, that it's a safety. فَهُوَ أَمَانٌ, it's a safety. You can't touch it. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he commented on the statement of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal in his book, rahimahullah. He said, فَهَذَا يَقْتَضِي إِنْعِقَادُهُ بِمَا يَعْتَقِدُهُ الْعِلْجُ وَإِنْ لَمْ يَقْصِدُهُ الْمُسْلِمُ وَلَوْ صَدَرَ مِنْهُ مَا يَدُلُّ عَلَيْهِ. Imam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he said, this indicates that the aman will take place based on what the ilj, the disbeliever, believes. وَإِلَّمْ even if not, يَقْصِدُهُ الْمُسْلِمُ, even if the Muslim didn't intend that. وَلَا صَدَّرَ مِنْهُ مَا يَدُلُّ عَلَيْهِ. And it hasn't even come from you that which meant that you were giving him safety. You didn't even say to him anything that could have even meant safety. Or you didn't even mean it, you meant something else. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah said, it shows that still the aman is going to take place. It's going to take place. Rather, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah in his kitab Sarim al-Maslul ala Shatim al-Rasul, the second volume, page 522, he said, وَمَعْلُومٌ أَنَّ شُبْهَةَ الْأَمَانِ كَحَقِيقَتِي فِي حَقْنِ الدِّمْ فِي حَقْنِ الدَّمْ. Ibn Taymiyyah said, it is known that the doubt of safety, it's all based upon assumption, a speculation. This individual assumes and speculates and has assumption that you gave him a covenant, you gave him your word that you're going to look after him and safety. Shubha, doubt. Ibn Taymiyyah said, كَحَقِيقَتِ. It is like you gave it literally to him. في حَقْنِ الدَّمْ, in saving his blood is protected like that. It is as though you said to him, I'm going to look after you. And you clearly said it to him. Even though it is what? It is shubha. It is all doubt. Ibn Abdul Barr rahimahullah, he said, كُلَّمَا اعْتَبَرَهُ الْحَرْبِيُّ أَمَانًا مِنْ كَلَامٍ أَوْ إِشَارَةٍ أَوْ إِذْنٍ فَهُوَ أَمَانٌ يجب على جميع المسلمين الوفاء به. Ibn Abdul Barr said in his kitab al-Istithkar fi sharh madahib al-ulama al-amsar, he said, everything that the disbeliever understands it to be safety, whether it's a speech, whether it's pointing at something, or even giving him permission to enter, فَهُوَ أَمَانٌ, it is safety. It is safety. يجب, it is obligatory, على جميع المسلمين الوفاء به. Every single Muslim has to fulfill that promise of making sure that that disbeliever is looked after and no one is allowed to harm him. So look what Ibn Abdul Barr rahimahullah mentions. He said, min kalamin, aw isharatin, aw idhnin, whether it's a speech, whether it's pointing something towards it, or even idhn. And I want you to underline that word idhn. Idhn means when you give him permission to enter the land. Now, here, what stands here in the issue of idhn, and I'm going to come back to it later, inshallah ta'ala, is the issue of visa. Visa is a form of covenant and it's a contract. When you get given a visa, it is an aman. You've given your word that you won't harm. Na'am. And you can't cause any harm or problems. Ulaysh, who's from the A'immatul Malikiyyah, he said something like that as well. He said, ثُمَّ الْأَمَانُ يَكُونُ بِلَفْظٍ. The aman can take place with a wording, or ishara mufhima, or even a ishara pointing, which is understood from it. Min sha'niha fahmul adu. Now, pay attention. The ishara, the pointing, and what you meant by the pointing, we're not going to ask you who did it, what you meant by it. We're asked the disbeliever what he understood from it. He said, oh, ishara mufhima, min sha'niha fahmul adu al amana minha. That the disbeliever understands from your pointing, that's safety. وَإِنْ قَسَدَ الْمُسْلِمُونَ, even if the Muslims intend, بِهَا ضَرُّ, even if we intended to harm him by pointing, we were actually trying to say to him, we're going to kill you, watch. Wallahi, we're going to kill you. That's what we said to him. And he understood it as that he's going to be looked after. And then he's going to give you an example. كَفَتْحِنَا المصحف. If we open the Mus'haf. And why are we opening the Mus'haf? We're trying to say, Wallahi, by the one who these is his words, we're going to kill you. وَحَلْفِنَا أَنَّا نَقْتُلْهُمْ. Or we make an oath that we're going to kill him. فَظَنَّ And the disbeliever, the kafir, thinks, تَأْمِينًا. He thinks it's safety. فَهُوَ تَأْمِينٌ. It's safety. You were clearly saying to him, I'm going to kill you. In a language that he doesn't understand. And you said that to him, and he understood it as though you were trying to look, you were saying that you're going to look after him. He understood it as that. Then the issue isn't what you meant or what you even said. It is what he understood from it. تَأْمِينًا فَهُوَ تَأْمِينٌ. Relations from the Aimatul Malikiya. Ibn Abdul Barr is from the Aimatul Malikiya. Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah is from the Aimatul Hanabila. Ibn Qudama also sahibu Kitabul Mughni, which is the sharh of Mukhtasar al-Khiraqi. He mentions that as well. Now, what do you call it? Sarkhasi. From Aimatul Hanafiya. Sarkhasi, he mentions. He said, Al-Amanu mamniyun ala tawsi'a wa adna shuba yakfi li ithbati. He said, the Aman, safety and a covenant and a promise of making, saying to a disbeliever, I'm going to give you safety. It is built upon tawsi'ah. Tawsi'ah means that it's unrestricted, it's open. وَأَدْنَا الشُّبَةِ Meaning it's so vast, it is whatever he understands it as. It's not restricted and tied down and you have this. These are the only things that makes it into a contract. That it is open. مَبْنِيُّ عَلَى التَّوْسِعَةِ وَأَدْنَا الشُّبَةِ The minimum doubt يَكْفِي لِإِثْبَاتِ It's sufficient to affirm it. The minimum doubt that he says, I thought that was what? That's a covenant. And it's a contract. Al-Qirafi, he says it in his kitab as well. Rather, the ulama, they even mention, if the person doesn't talk, he doesn't point towards anything, just by even hanging around or befriending a person, that's a covenant. If you're friends with somebody, you can't turn around and kill him later. And that is the hadith of Al-Imam, Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah ta'ala, the long hadith, that Mughirah ibn Shu'bah, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, was a companion, but he did this before he became a companion. He befriended a group of people, this is before Islam, or before he took Islam. And they all went to Muqawqis. Muqawqis was the leader of Iskandariya, Alexandria. So when they went to him, the leader Muqawqis, he gave gifts to all of them, but he gave Mughira less. He gave Mughira less. So Mughira became very angry and jealous. So what he did was, he gave them all alcohol, they drank, they became intoxicated, and they became drunk. So what he done, he took his sword out, he killed them all, he took their money and everything that was given to them, and he came to the Prophet ﷺ in Medina, and he took Islam. The Messenger ﷺ said to Mughira, أَمَّا الْإِسْلَامُ As for your Islam, فَأَقْبَلْنَا As for your Islam, we've accepted it from you. أَمَّا الْإِسْلَامُ فَقَدْ قَبِلْنَا As for your Islam, we've accepted that from you. As for أَمَّا الْمَالُ As for your wealth, فَلَسْتُ مِنْهُ فِي شَيْءٍ It has nothing to do with me. And it's got nothing to do with us. As for your Islam, it's accepted. But as for the money that you took, it is not. It's got nothing to do with us. That riwayah Abi Dawood explains it even more. When Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullah ta'ala, he authenticated in his Sunnah Abi Dawood. That the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in another wedding, وَأَمَّا الْمَالُ As for the wealth, فَإِنَّهُ مَالُ غَدْرٍ As for the wealth, you took it from deceit. لَا حَاجَّةَ لَنَا فِيهِ We have no need for it. We have no need from it. So you have to underline that word, which is فَإِنَّهُ مَالٌ It is wealth, which you took from what? غَدَر, deceive. You deceived them. لَا حَاجَّةَ لَنَا فِيهِ There is nothing we want from it. Hafidh ibn Hajar, rahimahullah, Hafidh ibn Hajar, a great scholar, who commented on this hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari. He commented on it in his great book, Fathul Bari. Ibn Hajar, rahimahullah, he said, وَأَمَّا الْمَالُ فَلَسْتُ مِنْهُ فِي شَيْءٍ That particular point, when he was explaining it, he said, "A, it means, لا أتعرض له لكونه أخذه غدرا." He said, "This had it means that this wealth of yours, I have nothing to do with it. What it means is that I am not going to take it from you because you took it from deceit, Mughira. You deceived them when you took it. ويستفاد منه Ibn Hajar is still, he's still carrying on, and he said, what is benefited from this hadith is, أَنَّهُ لَا يَحِلُّ, that it is not permissible, أَخْذُ أَمْوَالِ الْكُفَّارِ, that it's not permissible to take the wealth of the disbelievers. It's not allowed to. فِي حَالِ الْأَمْنِ غَدَرًا, that it's not permissible to take their money and their wealth at a time when it's safety and it's peace and you're in there and you've given them that covenant. فِي حَالِ الْأَمَنِ غَدَرًا, it's deceived. You've deceived them. Why? لِأَنَّ الرُّفْقَةَ يَصْطَحِبُونَ عَلَى الْأَمَانَةِ. Because when a person takes you as a partner to, or he takes you as a friend to travel with you, he's only taking you as a friend to travel with because it is what? It's because I find in you a man. You're safe. You see? It is because لِأَنَّ الرُّفْقَةَ يَصْطَحِبُونَ عَلَى الْأَمَانَةِ. Because the people who are going with one another are going with each other because they find safety from one another. وَالْأَمَانَةُ تُؤَدَّى إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا مُسْلِمًا كَانَ أَوْ كَافِرًا. And the safety is given to its individual, the person. Whether he's a Muslim or kafir, it doesn't matter, Ibn Hajar said. وَأَنَّ الْأَمْوَالَ الْكُفَّارِ, and as for the wealth of the kuffar, إِنَّمَا تَحِلُّ بِالْمُحَارَبَةِ وَالْمُغَالَبَةِ. When their money is permissible, it is when we're fighting with them and there's a battle taking place. But not a time of halal aman. إِنْتَهَ كَلَامُ Ibn Hajar's speech is over. Badruddin al-Ayni rahimahullah in his Umdatul Qari, which is the sharah of Sahih al-Bukhari as well. Badruddin al-Ayni is a Hanafi. He commented on this hadith as well. He said, أَنَّ الْمُشْرِكِينَ, the pagans and the polytheists, وَإِنْ كَانَتْ أَمْوَالُهُمْ مَغْنُومَةً عِنْدَ الْقَهْرِ فَلَا يَحِلُّ أَخْذُهَا عِنْدَ الْأَمْنِ وَإِذَا كَانَ الْإِنسَانُ مُصَاحِبًا لَهُمْ فَقَدْ أَمِنَ كُلُّ وَاحِدٍ مِّنْهُمْ صَاحِبَهُ فَسَفْكُ الدِّمَاءِ وَأَخْذُ الْمَالِ عِنْدَ ذَلِكَ غَدَرٌ وَالْغَدَرُ مَحْذُورٌ. He said, the pagans and the polytheists, even that the wealth is taken at a time of battle, when we're fighting with them, their wealth is taken. But it's not permissible at a time of safety. It is not. Because وَإِذَا كَانَ الْإِنسَانُ مُصَاحِبًا لَهُمْ, because when a person is in companionship with them, فَقَدْ أَمِنَ, he's taken them, he's given him safety. When you befriend somebody and you're with them, you've given them safety because he's taken you as a companion. فَقَدْ أَمِنَ كُلُّ وَاحِدٍ مِّنْهُمْ صَاحِبًا. Everyone is, he's given his word that he's going to be safe to him. By action, not verbally. فَسَفْكُ الدِّمَاءِ, to spill the blood at that time. وَأَخْذُ الْمَالِ, and to take his wealth whilst traveling with him. ذَلِكَ غَدَرٌ, that is deceit. وَالْغَدَرُ مَحْذُورٌ, and deceit is prohibited. So brothers and sisters, now what we need to do is, this issue that we spoke about, which is crystal clear now, what we really need to understand is that how the word aman in our sharia, what is the dhabit for it? We understood that it is based upon adna shubah, the minimum speculation and doubt. And it doesn't matter what you meant, it is what the disbeliever understood from it. Nowadays what falls under it, based on the world and how it functions today, is ta'shir al-dukhul, these visas, these stamps, it takes a contract. And the qa'idah which the ulama mention is that the aadah, the custom, it determines. The custom today in the world, the way that governments go through, people come into countries and they give their covenant, and it is by way of stamping their passport or giving them an exit or entry visa. Those are promises and oaths that you've given. And that qa'idah, which is al-'adatu muhakkama, is one of the qawa'id al-khams al-kubra, is from one of the five principles which is accepted amongst all of the fuqaha and the usuliyin. It's accepted amongst them. And they summarize them in three lines. خَمْسُ مُقَرَّرَةُ قَوَاعِدُ مَذْهَبٍ لِلشَّافِعِيِّ فَكُنْ بِهِنَّ خَبِيرًا ضرر يزال وعادة قد حكمت وكذا المشقة تجلب التيسيرا والشك لا ترفع به متيقنا والقصد أخلص إن أردت أجورا. Sometimes they say والشك لا ترفع به متيقنا والقصد أخلص إن أردت أمورا, they say as well. This qa'ida, which is this principle, which is that the custom determines, which is ضرر يزال وعادة قد حكمت وكذا المشقة تجلي بالتيسيرة. The custom determines, and that's, there's evidence for it in the Quran and also in the Sunnah. Allah تبارك وتعالى, he said in the Quran, خذ العفو وأمر بالعرف وأعرض عن الجاهلين. خذ العفو, take forgiveness with you. وأمر بالعرف, an order, عرف. عرف is what? The custom. And Imam Ibn Atiyah رحمه الله, he mentions what the word وأمر بالعرف means. He commented on that point and he said معناه, it means بكل ما عرفته النفوس مما لا ترده الشريعة. It is everything that the soul recognizes and it affirms that we all agree upon. لكن مما لا ترده الشريعة, but the Sharia does not reject it. And it doesn't go against the religion. This custom cannot go against the religion. Also, Allah تبارك وتعالى said in the Quran, وَعَلَى الْمَوْلُودِ لَهُ رِزْقُهُنَّ وَكِسْوَتُهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. The women, upon the man is how does he have to look after, وَعَلَى الْمَوْلُودِ, sorry, the child, sorry, that's born. The child that is born, لَهُ رِزْقُهُنَّ, they have their food and their provision, وَكِسْوَتُهُنَّ, and their clothing, بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, in good. Also Allah said about the wife, وَعَاشِرُهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, live with the women in good. Now the ma'ruf here is, what is, what's good? $2,000, $5,000, £2, £3, what is meant by good? What is the وَعَاشِرُهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَعَلَى الْمَوْلُودِ لَهُ رِزْقُهُنَّ وَكِسْوَتُهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. What's the ma'ruf? The ada, the custom determines this. Whatever land that you're at, the way that the people of that land, they consider ma'ruf is what you're going to do. Also the hadith of Hinda رضي الله تعالى عنها, when she came to the Prophet and she said, Ya Rasulullah, Abu Sufyan is a رجل شحيح, is a man who is stingy. The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, خذي أنت وبنوك, take yourself, for yourself and your child, ما يكفيك بالمعروف, take what suffices you in good. Again, the Prophet didn't say take this much money and this amount. What she takes is based upon the ma'ruf custom. What would she need to buy food? And so this issue of adam muhakkama has our, in our religion, a place. So now visas, traveling into countries, going into places, countries to countries, this is a covenant and it's a promise and aman that you gave. And also Ibn Abd al-Barr's statement that I mentioned before, rahimahullah, he said, كُلَّمَا عَتَبَرَهُ الْحَرْبِيُّ أَمَانًا مِنْ كَلَامٍ أَوْ إِشَارَةٍ أَوْ إِذْنٍ, or coming into a country, he permitted you to come into this country, this is as though you gave him a condition that you're not going to harm him. Because the qa'ida is what? الْمَعْرُوفُ عُرْفًا كَالْمَشْرُوطِ شَرْطًا. The thing that is known by way of custom, anything that is known by way of custom, it's known. It is like a condition that you and I both took towards one another. It is known. It's like we already agreed on this. The custom, and this is a qa'ida, which I mentioned is evidence for. Brothers, our religion, it even went to explain and not leave us with anyone to just come and add to the religion what he wants, or to take off wherever he wants, or to base things on his own whims and desires. What about if the disbeliever, he breaks his covenant, he breaks it, and he comes with that which nullifies the covenant or the oath that was set with him? For example, he kills a person, and he comes with the things that will break the ahd and the mithaq that was set with him. Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah in his kitab Rawdatul Talibin wa Umdatul Muftin, he mentions, he says, فَأَمَّا مَنْ دَخَلَ دَارَنَا, anyone who enters our land, بِأَمَانٍ, with safety, أَوْ مُدَاهَنَةٍ فَلَا يُغْتَالُ, he cannot be assassinated. Anyone who enters our land by way of contract, he was given either a hudna, or either was given an ahd or a mithaq, or a man, and he came into our land, we're not allowed to kill him. We're not allowed to. فَلَا يُغْتَالُ, he can't be assassinated. وَإِنْ انْتَقَضَ عَهْدُ, even if he breaks his covenant, even if the contract breaks, وَإِنْ انْتَقَضَ عَهْدُ, even then, we're still not allowed to kill him. بَلْ يَبْلُغُ الْمَأْمَنَ, rather, بَلْ يُبَلَّغُ الْمَأْمَنَ, rather, he is reached and he's taken to a safe place. هَذَا إِذَا نَقَضَ جَمِيعُهُمُ الْأَهْدَ, and that is only if all of them break the covenant. Not some. If some break, the only ones who broke it are taken out, the rest they still remain. But if all of them as a body They break it. We're not allowed to, we're not allowed to kill them. We're not allowed to cause them any harm. The Muslim leader, he takes them and he takes them to a safe place, wherever they think they're the safest at. And they take it to that place. And we tell them from this minute onwards, there is no contact between you and us. So you can't kill a ambassador or a, go to an embassy and kill the people inside the embassy because they came to the place with an aman. If they do break the covenant, then the Muslim leader, it's his job, not your job. It is his job to take them out of the land and to place them elsewhere. Another thing that I wanted to speak about, inshallah ta'ala, is what is the issue in the in our religion pertaining to, can some Muslims have a covenant with the disbelievers? Can they have a covenant with them and a contract whilst other Muslims are fighting with them? Or since there are Muslims already fighting with them, does that mean every Muslim has to fight with them? Or can there some have contract with them? And some are having contracts with them, and the rest are what? Are fighting with them. Can we do that? This is a good question. The scholars in the fuqaha, they speak about this issue. And it's mentioned, which is taba'ud al-ahkam. The ruling dividing amongst the people. Meaning, whilst there's a group of people who have a contract with the disbelievers, another group of people could be fighting with them. The ones who are fighting can't force the ones who have the contract to fight. And the ones who have the contract can't tell the ones who are fighting to stop fighting. Each one has his own, because the hukum differs for both of them. And this is clearly stated in the Qur'an and the Sunnah. Allah Ta'ala said in the Qur'an, وَإِنِ اسْتَنْصَرُوكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ فَعَلَيْكُمُ النَّصْرُ إِلَّا عَلَىٰ قَوْمٍ بَيْنَكُمْ وَبَيْنَهُمْ مِيثَاقٌ وَاللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ بَصِيرٌ. If a group of Muslims, وَإِنِ اسْتَنْصَرُوكُمْ, if a group of Muslims ask for victory, they ask for aid in the religion, they call on to you, brothers, come help us. فَعَلَيْكُمُ النَّصْرُ, you have to go and help them. And you have to give them support when they call on to you. Allah then says, إِلَّا أَكْسَبْتْ عَلَىٰ قَوْمٍ بَيْنَكُمْ وَبَيْنَهُمْ مِيثَاقٍ. Except a people you have a covenant with. If, for example, a Muslim group of people are fighting with a group of people we have a covenant with, Allah is saying to us, don't give victory to them on this. Because you have a covenant, stick to your covenant. إِلَّا عَلَىٰ قَوْمٍ بَيْنَكُمْ وَبَيْنَهُمْ مِيثَاقٍ. وَاللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ بَصِيرٌ. That is the ayah in the Quran, which Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala mentions it. And this is the ayah 72, I think, in Surah Al-Anfal, last page of Surah Al-Anfal. Surah Al-Anfal finishes with 75 ayat. This is the last ayah, page, safha. Good. Also the hadith of the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that the Messenger Alayhi Salatu Wasallam, the Sulh Al-Hudaybiyah, the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, in which he signed with the Kufar of Quraysh. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he signed a treaty with Quraysh contract. He took a contract with them. And when he signed the contract and he agreed with them, one of the things that the Prophet ﷺ agreed was that if a Muslim comes to him, that he will send that Muslim back to them. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He signed that with them and he agreed to that. Alayhi salatu wasalam. Naam. And the person who was signing the contract with the Messenger Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was representing Quraysh, was Suhail ibn Amr. Suhail ibn Amr was the one representing Quraysh. So he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the first person who I'm going to bring into this contract is my son Abu Jandal. His son Abu Jandal was sitting there right there. He said, I want him, pass him over to me. The Prophet said to him, look, Abu Jandal was before the contract. He said, nope, until you give him to me, the contract doesn't start. It starts from him. So the Prophet told him to go with his father. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said something to Abu Jandal. Look what he said to him. He said, Ya Abu Jandal, ihtasib. Abu Jandal, wait for reward from Allah. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ, for verily Allah, عَاجِلُ لَكَ وَلِمَنْ مَعَكَ مِنَ الْمُسْتَضْعَفِينَ فَرَجًا وَمَخْرَجًا. Allah is going to hasten for you and those who are with you from the weak Muslims a opening. Allah is going to give you guys an opening. Look what the Prophet already did. He divided himself from Abu Jandal and the weak Muslims. And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this is to show you what? Taba'ud. That the aman, that we are in what? We are in the covenant. You guys are not. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ جَاعِلُ لَكَ وَلِمَنْ مَعَكَ مِنَ الْمُسْتَضْعَفِينَ فَرَجًا وَمَخْرَجًا إِنَّا قَدْ عَقَدْنَا بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَ الْقَوْمِ عَقْدًا وَصُلْحًا. We, on the other hand, so you guys, inshallah ta'ala, and those who are with you, Abu Jandal, from the weak Muslims, may Allah give you guys an opening and ease in your matter. And Allah will, the Prophet said to him. But he said, "Inna, as for us, قَدْ عَقَدْنَا بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَ الْقَوْمِ عَقْدًا وَصُلْحًا. We took with the people, and we have with them a contract, and we have a treaty set with them. وَإِنَّا لَا نَغْدِرْ. And we can't break that covenant. And we can't break that that treaty that we have with them. So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what did he do? He told Abu Jandal that he cannot help him, and he can't give him victory, and he can't aid him. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, straight after he signed that contract or that treaty with Kufar of Quraysh, none other than Abu Basir radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he came to Medina. And he came after a very short time, بعد فترة وجيزة. It was a very short time after the Treaty of Hudaybiyah. When he came to the Prophet ﷺ, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, right after Abu Basir came in, two of the kuffar of Quraysh came right after him. And they said, "Ya Muhammad, al-ahd alladhi ja'alta lana, the covenant, the treaty that you made with us." We want Abu Basir. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed Abu Basir to the two men. And he said, "Go with them." Our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is passing him over to them. So Abu Basir was taken. Abu Basir, when he got taken, they tied him up, they took him. And when they took him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, on the way Abu Basir realized that the rope wasn't as tight as they should have made it. So he took one of the swords of the men, he released himself, and he killed, there were two, he killed one, and the other one ran away from him. The one that ran away came to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam running. He came to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when he came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he came in and the Prophet saw him from far. And then he said, "This man has seen something that terrorized him." So when he came in, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what did he do? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he saw Abu Basir right after him. And when he saw him, Abu Basir came to the Prophet, he said, "Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, you have done your promise," meaning you stuck to your side of the contract to send me back. And you did do that. And Allah saved me. There's no need for you to send me back again. There's no need to. You don't have to send me back. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he looked at Abu Basira, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, "Wayla ummi mis'aru harbin law kana lahu ahad." He said, "Oh, this man, Abu Basira, he's a man who can fight. He knows how to fight. If only he was to have, لَوْ كَانَ لَهُ أَحَدٍ. If only he had somebody on his side. If only he had somebody aiding him." Abu Basira رضي الله تعالى عنه, and he had وَلَهُ نَصِيبٌ مِنْ اسْمِهِ. He had a understanding. His name is Abu Basira, a man of insight. So he looked at the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, and he realized that the Messenger was telling him, "Ya Abu Basira." He realized from the statement of the Prophet that no one is going to help him. وَيْلُ أُمِّ مِسْعَرُ حَرْبٍ لَوْ كَانَ لَهُ أَحَدٍ. If only he had a person. So Abu Basira رضي الله تعالى عنه, the Prophet told him that no one's going to help you. Abu Basira got up, he realized that no one's going to help him, and he went away. The shahid from this brothers is what? That the covenant or the ahd or the treaty or the mithaq, a group of people can hold it with the disbelievers whilst others are in a state of war. They can be. So Abu Basira, he went back. He never went back to Medina, Mecca. He stayed in the around the area of the sea and the ocean. And when he stayed there, wherever they came with across to whatever they came with, Quraysh, and they would walk, they would take from Sham, and they would take it back to Mecca, he would take it from him. Abu Jandal, who was in Mecca, he heard Abu Basira was there. So he went and he met him. And so they became a group that was in the middle. Wherever Quraysh owned, they would take it from them. Now, Abu Basira, he is not under the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam's contract. He's not under the Prophet's contract, alayhi salatu wasalam. And the Prophet stuck to the covenant that he gave Quraysh. You guys wanted him? There he is. I sent him back. If he's caused you guys harm, it's up to you guys. Even Quraysh never came to the Prophet Muhammad and said, "Ya Muhammad, you broke the covenant. You broke the promise. Why are they fighting with us?" Because they knew that they were not part of the covenant, the contract. That the contract was only Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and those who were with him in Medina. So inshallah ta'ala, brothers and sisters, I want to remind you all inshallah ta'ala that these matters are masail fiqhiyya, masail which are based on knowledge and understanding. Don't just come and say and speak about these issues by saying yajuz, la yajuz, it is permissible, it's not permissible, and just speak without knowledge. These matters, ikhwani, it needs a ta'seel al-ilmi. It needs a person to foundate himself upon understanding and to have insight of the matter before you talk and before you say anything. Anything which I have said, ikhwani and akhawati, which was wrong, it's from me and shaitan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh.